Amen. Well, welcome our friends once again to the Prophecy Odyssey program. Myself, Doug Batchelor, and the entire Amazing Facts team is so thankful to be here with you in New York City again. And for me, this is coming home in a way. I was 6 years old when my mom moved my brother and I to New York City. And we live 51st Street on the east side, 81st Street on the west side. And I'll tell you, that's quite an education. Across the street from the Hayden Planetarium, Central Park, and the Museum of Natural History. And so it's been a while, but it is good to be back here with you again, and for the most important thing, which is to open the Word of God. I want to welcome those who are joining us on TV. We've got people all across the globe that are watching. Tonight, we're going to be studying one of the most important subjects dealing with the prophecy of history. And if I was going to take one Bible subject and say, this is the study of prophecy that we're going to have tonight that convinced me that the Bible is a supernatural book, this is the one. And it's based on a chapter that you're going to find in the book of Daniel chapter 2. Of course, don't forget we have study guides, and you can download these from the Prophecy Odyssey website. We have study guides that go along with us, and this program, as I speak, is being translated into 16 different languages plus English. And the study guides are in most of those languages as well. You know, Jesus said the gospel of the kingdom will go into all the world, and then the end will come. Now, with our communications, I think this is the generation that could see the climax of all history with the coming of our Lord. Can you say amen?
Amen.
And I'm so thankful that we could be in this internationally known city as a springboard to sharing the gospel everywhere. Well, we always like to begin with an amazing fact, and I'm going to get my little clicker here that will take us through some of these things. From the very beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, we hear about a kingdom called Babylon. Now, if you have your Bibles on your phone, or if you've got a hard copy of the Bible, you might want to turn to the book of Daniel chapter 2, not far from the middle of the Bible there, Daniel chapter 2. Let me give you a little amazing fact about Babylon. Ancient Babylon had a massive impact on world history. It was a center of earthly mathematics, astronomy, and technology innovation. The Babylonians invented the wheel for work carts and chariots, sailboats to trade on the Euphrates River. They created cuneiform writing records. Babylon also developed a unique numerical system based on the lunar calendar with 360 days, which is, by the way, the same calendar as the Jews. Make a mental note of that, because a year with 360 days comes up later in understanding time prophecies. 30 days in a month is how they calculated units for measurement, and this is why we've got 60 seconds in a minute, and you've got the number 60 is all through the Babylonian calculations. They also divided the starry heavens into 36 constellations. I'm a pilot, 360 degrees to a circle, and we use that in mathematics now. They were excellent mathematicians. Interestingly, now don't miss this, the Babylonian sacred square is composed of six boxes by six boxes with a number one in box one, number two, three, four. When you add all those up, one through 36, it comes to 666. Babylon appears in the book of Revelation. And I hope you don't know what a roulette wheel is, but you know a roulette wheel has got 36 numbers on it. And if you add 1 plus 2 plus 3 up to 36, it comes to 666. 666 is a very unique number. Did you know if you add up the first six Roman numerals, you know, the Roman numerals I, V, X, so forth, adds up to 666. So this is going to play into prophecy, but that's just to whet your appetite. So the zenith of Babylonian history was during the reign of someone by the name of Nebuchadnezzar II. We don't know much or hear much about Nebuchadnezzar I, but Nebuchadnezzar II was an extremely intelligent, well-educated man, a master military man and an administrator, and he can also be brutal and ruthless, which is one reason he was able to conquer, struck fear into everybody. The zenith of the Babylonian Empire was from about 612 to 539 BC. And Nebuchadnezzar, in about 597, he came, and that was his first invasion of the land of Israel. During that time, he carried away about 10,000 captives. Among the captives that he carried away from Israel back to Babylon, there were four young men. By the way, this had been foretold by the prophet Isaiah to King Hezekiah. Hezekiah was told by Isaiah, "Your sons that issue from you will be carried off to the kingdom of Babylon and made eunuchs." And this is exactly what happened several hundred years later. So just a little map on the screen here for those that are watching to give you an idea of the extent of the Babylonian kingdom at its zenith, touching on the shores of five major oceans. Now, while we go through the prophecy tonight, I want to make something very clear. We're going to be talking about the major empires of the world that were foretold in prophecy before they existed. And the reason these empires are highlighted is they all occupied God's people that were then Israel. And this was also the crossroads between three continents of Europe, Africa, and Asia. So they saw this as a world empire because they controlled the trade between these continents. They were fabulously wealthy. So at the zenith of his power, and Nebuchadnezzar, he had an incredible passion for building. So he's building, how many of you have heard of the seven wonders of the ancient world? The only one that still survives today are the pyramids of Giza. Karen and I were there a couple years ago. Yeah, was it just last year? Whoa, time flies. And they had things like the Colossus of Rhodes and the Lighthouse of Alexandria. One of the seven wonders of the ancient world, according to Herodotus the historian, was the Hanging Gardens of Babylon. Nebuchadnezzar married a girl from the mountains, and Babylon is a plain. She was constantly homesick because there were no mountains. He said, "I will build you a mountain." She said, "But there are no trees." He said, "I will plant trees and mountains and flowers." And he built these beautiful, exotic hanging gardens. And some of the ancient historians say he had found some method to pump water from the Euphrates River up and irrigate it so there were waterfalls coming down from this man-made mountain that he had. So you have the picture in your mind, this massive kingdom, very powerful, very opulent. One historian says that it was 60 miles around the perimeter. That's bigger than Los Angeles today. Just, it was huge. Nebuchadnezzar went to sleep one night, and he was very proud of the way that God had, you know, blessed, and he thought he was pretty smart too. He was a proud man, and he knew this kingdom was great, and he wondered how long it would last. He understood history, how one kingdom fights against another. And in the midst of his sleeping this night, troubled, wondering how long the kingdom would last, he had a dream that was unlike any other dream. I don't know if you've had a dream and you said, that wasn't a normal dream, that was a three-dimensional dream. It was a vision. And he wanted to understand it. Now, if you have your Bibles, we're going to pause here and we're going to read about this. If you go to the book of Daniel chapter 2, we're not going to read the whole chapter, but we're going to do the introduction to this dream that Nebuchadnezzar had and what that stood for. What does that mean? Daniel chapter 2, and we'll read the first few verses here. Verse 1, Daniel chapter 2. Now in the second year of Nebuchadnezzar's reign, this isn't the second year that he was out fighting and conquering, but after his father died and he had complete control. In the second year of Nebuchadnezzar's reign, Nebuchadnezzar had dreams, and his spirit was so troubled that his sleep left him. Then the king gave the command to call the magicians, astrologers, the sorcerers, the Chaldeans, to tell the king his dreams. So they came and they stood before the king. He had a pretty big entourage of wise men and counselors, and they were all into the, you know, the occultish arts, and some of them were stargazers, and supposedly these are the wise men, the spiritual men. So they came and stood before him, and the king said, "I've had a dream, and my spirit is anxious to know the dream. And the Chaldean spoke to the king in Aramaic, O king, live forever. Tell your servants the dream, and we will give the interpretation. You see, they were in the business of the king would give a dream, and they'd concoct some interpretation to try to satisfy him. But he thought, no, I'm not a fool. He said, I want to know what this dream means, and I don't want you to just manufacture something. He says, if you're really wise men, and you're really connected with the gods, here's your chance to prove your mettle. I want you to tell me what I dream. Not only because that'll be good proof, but because it's starting to get fuzzy. How many of you have had a dream and you thought, wow, it was vivid, and half an hour later, you know, your dream is happening in a different brain level from your consciousness. And as you get into full consciousness, the dream is hard to access. And he's saying, I'll remember it when I hear it, but if you're wise men, you tell me what I dream, and then I'll know you know the interpretation. In verse 7, they said, King, let the king tell his servants a dream, and we'll give the interpretation. And the king answered and said rather sternly, I know for a certain that you would gain time. You're stalling, because you see my decision is firm. If you do not make known the dream to me, there's only one decree for you. You're on the royal payroll, and you're worthless, like others on the royal payroll around the world. Only one decree for you. You have agreed to speak lying and corrupt words before me until the time has changed. You think I'm just going to get on with something else and forget about this. Therefore, tell me the dream, and I'll know you can tell me the interpretation. And they answered and said to the king, there's not a man on earth who can tell the king's matter. Therefore, no king or lord or ruler has ever asked such a thing from any magician, astrologer, or Chaldean. It's a difficult thing the king is requesting, and there's no other one who can tell it to the king except the gods, whose dwelling is not with flesh. For this reason, the king was angry and very furious, and he gave a command to destroy all the wise men of Babylon. Now, the king back then could not just issue a fiat, kill them all. They had legal process, and so they're writing up a decree to gather them and execute them. So you understand it took a while to do this, but they're going to be under a death decree now because the king is mad. So the decree went out, and they began killing the wise men, and they sought Daniel and his companions to kill them. Now, at this point, we need to understand something that happened. So Daniel and his friends were wise men in training, and they had not yet been called in before the king. And so what happened is the guard comes in, and Daniel says, it looks like they're rounding up all the wise men. I don't know if we're in that category. We're sort of intern wise men, and we were not there, and maybe this is a little hasty from the king. Daniel remembered the story of Joseph in the Bible, where the king of Egypt had a dream and none of his wise men could understand, but Joseph trusted the Lord and God gave him an answer. And Daniel said to his friends, well, we serve the same God. Let's tell the king, give us a chance, and we'll tell him what his dream means. And that's what happened. The guard went in and said, you know, I've got some young Hebrews that you tested. You said they were pretty smart. They say that they can tell you what your dream means if you'll just pause the death decree. What have you got to lose? Give them 24 hours. Well, the king is thinking, well, I want to know what my dream means, and what have I got to lose? I don't want to just kill all the wise men and never know. If they think that they're going to know, and I seem to remember Hananiah, Mishael, Azariah, and Daniel. Their new names were Belshazzar, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, the Babylonian names. Said, okay, I'll give them some time. Now, this is where we launch into our study of what the dream was and what the dream meant. But before we get to that, we're going to go to the streets of New York. Can anybody know the future? We're going to go to our man and woman on the street and see what they have to say about that.
I think people can have visions. I think you can have a understanding of later, per se, future, yeah.
You know, that's a spiritual question for me, so possibly.
Yes.
I don't think that's true.
Probably, yeah, if you read the book of Revelation.
So again, the answers are all over the board. Can you know the church? I'm going to get an audience shot, just telling our directors so that they can be prepared. How many of you think that it is possible for someone to know the future by show of hands? That's kind of a mixed group here in New York, isn't it? I'm going to ask that question again later, after the study, and I want you to tell me if I've convinced any of you that it is possible for someone to understand what is coming in the future. All right, we're going to get into our lesson. Question number one, for those that are joining us for the first time, where have you been? We've got 13 more presentations to come. They're going to change your life. I promise you, you're going to draw closer to God, and you're going to have peace. You don't want to miss it. We use a question-answer format. Studies are here. You can find the answers in the Bible for yourself. Question number one, why did God give the Babylonian king this dream? The answer is right here in the Bible. Daniel 2, verse 28. But there is a God in heaven who reveals secrets. And you can call out the blue color with me. Reveals secrets, and he has made known to the king Nebuchadnezzar what will be in the latter days. And that means in the last days. So what is this dream dealing with? The past or the future? So you either believe the Bible or you don't. And I want you to know that we know with certainty that the book of Daniel was written hundreds of years before Christ because it was in the Dead Sea Scrolls, and it predates the Dead Sea Scrolls. Many of them were over 200 years before Christ. And Daniel, all of Jewish history, they know that book was written during the Babylonian captivity by the prophet himself. And if you don't believe that, just say you don't believe Jesus, because Jesus said that Daniel wrote the book of Daniel. Amen? So this is a book you can trust, or you can't trust anything. He says it's telling us what's coming in the future. Question number two. When the king's counselors failed to reveal and interpret the dream, what was Nebuchadnezzar's command? How did the king feel about that? The king gave command to what? Destroy all of the wise men of Babylon. And, you know, some of these wise men obviously weren't that wise, and they couldn't tell the king what his dream was. We get a lot of mail at Amazing Facts. You know, we broadcast, we're on not only 3ABN, we're on Trinity Broadcasting, Daystar, History Channel, Lifetime. Some of you have seen our programs. I get a lot of mail. I do my best to personally answer all I can. We have a team that helps us answer simple questions. You'd be surprised how many times people send me a dream. They said, Pastor Doug, I've had a dream. And they write out this dream, sometimes pages with illustrations. And they say, can you please tell me what my dream means? I say, I'm sorry, that's not my gift. I can't do that. So once again, we've got to go back and understand what happened. As I mentioned, in about 597, Nebuchadnezzar he'd conquered Israel. He came back and fought against them again and destroyed the temple. But when he first came, they agreed to terms of peace. He took 10,000 of their youngest and their brightest to bring them back to his college and train them in the language of the Chaldeans, in the mathematics, the sciences, the arts of Babylon, which at the time was considered the most sophisticated education in the world you could get back then. They were masters of mathematics. They studied the heavens. Some of you remember when Hezekiah was sick in the Bible, and the sun stood still, ambassadors came from Babylon to understand what caused that, what does it mean? So they brought among the captives, among those 10,000 were Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, Azariah. They were brought in, they were put in the Babylonian educational system for 3.5 years to study. Then the king tested them, this is Daniel chapter 1. And the king found them 10 times wiser than all of the other young men that had brought back from other countries. And so they were in training to be counselors and learning languages and the arts and the sciences and so forth. And so when the decree is going out to kill all of the wise men, they had not been invited. You can see in Daniel chapter 1 verse 3, it says, they were possessing knowledge and quick to understand, who had the ability to serve in the king's palace. Now from among those sons of Judah were Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Those were their Jewish names. They were later given Babylonian names. A lot of people in America that came to America through New York City and Ellis Island had names difficult to pronounce. And so the guards or whoever were processing the people there on Ellis Island said, we can't say that. Your name is Smith. How many of you know somebody like that? They came into the city, they had one name, and then they ended up with a new name that was a little easier. Number three, when Daniel learned about the death decree, what did he ask of the king? And he did this through the guard, Arioch. What did he ask, and what did he tell his friends? Answer, this is Daniel 2, verse 16. Daniel went in, and he asked the king to give him what? Time, that he might tell the king the interpretation. Well, Nebuchadnezzar, and this is a relief, an ancient relief that of Nebuchadnezzar, he thought, all right, I like these young men. I will postpone the mass execution. After all, they were not brought in with the others. Let's give them a chance. If they think they can tell me the dream, I want to know the dream. So what did they do? What would you do? Daniel went to his house. He made known the decision to Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, his companions, that they might seek mercies from the God of heaven concerning this secret. Does God reveal secret things to his prophets? He does. What happened that night in response to their earnest, heartfelt prayer? Can you imagine praying, saying, Lord, I need to have a dream tonight, but I don't need any dream. I need to dream the king's dream. But I not only need to dream the king's dream, I need to know what the king's dream meant. That is a pretty big prayer. That takes pretty big faith. What happened in response to that prayer, and to whom did Daniel and his friends give the credit? Answer, Daniel 2, verse 19 and verse 28. Then the secret was revealed, not to all of them, but to Daniel. So Daniel blessed the God of heaven. And he said, there is a God in heaven who reveals secrets. And you're going to have some secrets revealed to you tonight, friends, that I think are going to change your life. By the way, God answers prayer. These meetings are an answer to prayer. Amen. Take my word for it. Do you know before the program last night, the computers crashed, everything went wrong, and they were praying backstage. And just as the program began, it all came back online. God answers prayer, I'll tell you. Question number five. What two principal objects did Daniel say he saw in the dream? So the dream is composed of two principal things. Now, I want to read this to you. Go back to your Bibles again. Let me read what Daniel saw. He's brought before the king, and the king says, what can you tell me? Have you had the dream? And go to verse 31, Daniel chapter 2. You, O king, were watching. And matter of fact, I'm going to stand to the side here, and those of you in the hall, if you look on the screen, you might even actually see what Daniel saw in his dream in Nebuchadnezzar. You, O king, were watching, and behold, a great image. And this image, whose splendor was excellent, stood before you. Its form was awesome. Its image's head was of fine gold, its chest and its arms of silver. Its belly and its thighs of bronze, its legs of iron, its feet partly iron and partly of clay. You watched while a stone was cut without hands, which struck the image on its feet of iron and clay and broke them in pieces. Then the iron and the clay and the bronze and the silver and the gold were crushed together and became like the chaff from the summer threshing floor. And the wind carried them away, so no trace of them was found. And the stone that struck the image became a great mountain, filled the whole earth. There you have the dream. Did you see the image, friend? Yes. All right. It may show up again before we're over, because we're going to need to review that. So back to our lesson. Let's talk about what this is all about. The Bible is clear. If you look at the Ten Commandments, who knows what the second commandment is? Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven images. This is what you would call in the Bible an image. He had a dream of an image. Images represent false religion. And these false religions, with all the metals and minerals in this image, represent people worshiping idols of gold and silver and bronze and iron and clay, porcelain, whatever. The things of the world that they worship, counterfeit religion, kingdoms in the world that are in opposition to the kingdom of God. But finally, in the end, you've got a stone that is cut, notice, without man's hands. Do you know when the Jews built their altar, they were told, do not lift up your tool upon it. You will pollute it. Don't be tempted to start carving it into some statue of a cow or something. He said, take rough stone. I want it to be a stone without man's hands. And it will destroy all the other kingdoms. It will grow into a mountain and fill the whole earth. And mountains in the Bible represented kingdoms. The kingdom of Christ is that stone cut without man's hands. It's the stone that brought down Goliath. Amen? It is the stone, Jesus said, if you build your house on this stone. What is the stone? He that hears these words of mine and does them is a wise man who's building on the rock. And the storm will come and the house will stand. I hope you're building on the rock, friends. So this is talking about the kingdoms of the world, and it outlines the kingdoms that will occupy God's people that will ultimately be destroyed. All right, back to our lesson. What are the two things that are mentioned in the image? Daniel 2, verse 31. You, O king, were watching, and behold, a great image. You can also say a great idol. Babylonians had no shortage of idols, neither did the other succeeding kingdoms. The other thing that's very different, that is separate, that crushes the idol, you watched while a what? A stone was cut without hands. Again, Ten Commandments written on what? By the finger of God, not the hands of man. So notice the contrast here. And in the image you've got, and they can put it back up again, I just want to review it because we're going to go through it. You end up with, you've got the gold, and then you've got the silver, you've got the bronze, you've got the iron, and then you've got the clay in the feet, and the clay is mixed with iron. All right, you got that picture? Okay, we're going to say goodbye to our idol for a minute as we go on with the lesson here. So when Nebuchadnezzar is sitting here and Daniel is relating the image, the king is saying, all right, wise guy, you said you think you know my dream? What's my dream? He begins to tell the king this whole dream, and what do you think the king's face looked like? He's going, oh, yeah, yeah. Huh? How did you get inside my head? How did you know that? And after Daniel tells the king exactly what he saw with great specificity, then when Daniel says, now I'm going to tell you what it means. First of all, the king's ready to worship Daniel. And Daniel says, no, I can't tell you your dream. Daniel's so humble, he gives God the glory. He says, God, this is from God. He tells it to you. Now he begins to give the interpretation. All right, first part. Let's find out what this all means. What does the head of gold represent? Daniel said, and this is Daniel chapter 2, verse 38, you are this. Say the answers with me. You are the what? The head of gold. Meaning, Nebuchadnezzar, you and your kingdom of Babylon is a golden empire. And it was the gold was their currency. And it was one of the most splendid empires of the ancient world. And this is why it is called the head of gold. It was a world empire that affected the then civilized world. Again, I know the Incas had a kingdom, not quite at this time, but you had great kingdoms in China, and there were great kingdoms in Cambodia and India. And we're not trying to diminish from other great empires. This vision is dealing with the empires that occupied God's people that were the guardians of the word. You realize that the Jewish nation, God gave the oracles of truth to them. The Bible is mostly written by Jews. You know that. You okay with that? And if you're a Christian, the Bible says you are Abraham's seed. So this is talking about the preservation of God's word that would go to the world, the kingdoms that occupied them. And you're going to see all this if you paid any attention at all when you were in elementary school to world history. We know about Babylon, how it was a world empire. Amazing fact, historians say the walls of Babylon were over 200 feet high and 50 feet wide, allowing for four chariots to ride abreast on the top of the walls. And as I said, one historian said they were 15 miles on each side. They had inner and outer walls, and they thought it would never be conquered. Once again, the map that talks about the extent of their domain was massive. Controlling the trade between three continents, all that money was pouring in. How many of you have been to Dubai? Have you been to Dubai? I've been there several times. If you've never been there, it is the richest city in the world. Maybe Singapore, Dubai, but Dubai is different. Just the city was built out of the desert. They've got a river of money that flows into that city from oil. And I have been in hotel rooms that had, I didn't stay there, someone showed it to me, that had golden toilet seats. I am not exaggerating, I saw it. I mean, the wealth, the cars there, Bugattis, Lamborghinis, Maseratis, everywhere. Car 5 or 6 years old, not allowed on the road, too old. The money, incredible. Well, Babylon was like the Dubai back then. Fabulous military power. That was incredible. You are the head of gold. Number 7, would the kingdom of Babylon last forever? That was the king's concern. As he slept, he said, what will happen to my posterity? Nebuchadnezzar reigned about 39 years, and he wanted his sons, his successors, to have an eternal dynasty. But Daniel said, no, it's not going to happen that way. Babylon, he said, was going to fall. Now, you need to know how it happened historically. It's given a little bit in the Bible, but not all the detail. The Euphrates River ran under the walls of Babylon. And the Euphrates River was much bigger then than it is now. By the way, there's a prophecy in Revelation that said that the Euphrates River will dry up in the sixth plague. Have you read that? Did you know? All you have to do is listen to news reports, and they say the Euphrates River is drying up. Now, I don't think we're in the sixth plague yet. We'll explain the plagues later, but I think it's very interesting. Well, they had mighty ships that were navigating way up the Euphrates River. Now, man, you can't drag a toad through the river. It's becoming a series of stagnating pools down because Turkey and up higher, they're damming the water, and there's been droughts, and things have changed. But what happened is after Nebuchadnezzar died, for 1 year, his son Evil-Merodach was king, and he was assassinated, and it ended up, his uncle ended up becoming king. And the uncle was off fighting other battles, and the grandson, Belshazzar, was in charge of the kingdom. And the Persians and the Medes realized that they did not have the military might, meaning the Babylonians, that the Persians had. Nebuchadnezzar was gone, and he was a military genius. And Cyrus the Persian and Darius the Mede, they thought, we can conquer Babylon. They surrounded the city. They were going to besiege the city. The king, this young whippersnapper, and you find this in Daniel chapter 5. Belshazzar said, we don't need to be afraid of them. They will never get through our walls. We've got our soldiers. We've got our massive gates. We'll starve them. We've got enough food in the city. We got the water running under the walls. They can't sustain their army long enough. And they had a big party in the city of Babylon, and they all got drunk. And in the peak of the reveille, this blasphemous young king, he knew that his grandfather Nebuchadnezzar had been turned to Jehovah from Daniel. And they resented that. And he said, this God of the Jews, he has no power, and we're going to prove it. Bring me the vessels we captured from Jerusalem. We're going to praise our idols. And they took the holy vessels from the temple of God. And all of the Babylonian lords and leaders began to drink and to mock the gods of heaven, the God of heaven, Jehovah. And in the middle of this blasphemous, drunken revelry, all of a sudden, over against the plaster on the wall, a bloodless giant hand appeared. Kind of like Thing in the Addams Family. And it began to write the words, meeny, meeny, tekel, you farson. You've ever heard the expression, the handwriting on the wall? And when the king looked up and everybody saw this, they dropped their cups and their knees began, the Bible says his knees were smiting together. And he said, what does it say? Nobody knew. Bring in the wise men. They didn't know. They didn't know any more than they knew 39 years earlier when Nebuchadnezzar called them. And finally the queen mother said, you know, if you want to understand a vision, you need to call in a Jew. And there is a man in your kingdom. Gives me goosebumps whenever I say that. She said, there is a man. God still has some people. There is a man who is close to the Lord. He understands God. He'll tell you what this will say. Daniel is brought in. The king said, tell me what the writing says, and I'll give you a golden necklace, like he cared, you know, and a special garment, and make you third ruler in the kingdom. The reason he said you'll be third ruler is because Belshazzar was only second ruler. And Daniel said, keep your rewards, because I know what it says, and you're not going to be in any position to give anybody anything pretty soon. He said, it says, meeny, meeny, tekel, upharsin. You are weighed in the balances and found wanting. You are being judged. And the kingdom is being divided and given to the Medes and the Persians. And at that very moment, that mighty general Cyrus had diverted the Euphrates River way upstream into a dry lake bed. The water level where it went underneath the walls of Babylon dropped precipitously during the night. The soldiers of Babylon inside the city were drunk because they thought there was no attack. They had left the inner gates unlocked because they thought, well, they haven't gotten to the outer gates yet, no problem. Just like Trojan soldiers, a contingent of Persian army went underneath the walls. They came up, they opened the gates. The Persians and the Medes swarmed into the city, and in one night Babylon fell, that mighty city. And it is foretold in the Bible in incredible accuracy. Long before it happened, Isaiah lived long before Daniel. Do you have a Bible? You can go to, go to Jeremiah, actually. We'll start there. Go to Jeremiah chapter 50. By the way, why is this important? If you want to understand Revelation, Revelation 18 talks about the fall of Babylon. Jeremiah chapter 50 and 51 talk about the fall of Babylon. Isaiah chapter 13 talks about the fall of Babylon. Not only was there a Babylon in the Old Testament, there is a Babylon today. The Bible tells us in the last days there's a Babylon and God's people are being called out of Babylon. You need to know what you're supposed to come out of. So we need to understand the subject of Babylon. But here you can just look in Jeremiah chapter 50. He discusses the fall of Babylon, the utter destruction of Babylon. Thus says the Lord, this is 51, behold, I'll raise up against Babylon and against those who dwell in Leb-Kamala a destroying wind. It says that the soldiers will be afraid. Let me see here. The king of Babylon has heard a report, verse 43 of chapter 50, and his hands grow feeble, and anguish has taken hold of him as pangs of a woman with childbirth. And it goes on to say, the gates will be left open. And it says, their soldiers have become like women, they cannot fight. The city fell in one night. And in Isaiah it says, the rivers would be dried up in ancient Babylon. Look at Isaiah chapter 45. Now I've switched from Jeremiah to Isaiah. Isaiah wrote this about 700 AD, hundreds of years before King Cyrus was born. Thus says the Lord to his anointed. The Dead Sea Scrolls have the entire book of Isaiah. We know this was written, it's ancient prophecy. Thus says the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I have held, to subdue nations before him, to loose the armor of kings, to open before him the double doors, so the gates will not be shut. I will go before you and make the crooked places straight. I will break in pieces the gates of bronze and cut the bars of iron. Just read all of this. It foretells what happened. And that's why when you get to Revelation, it talks about the Euphrates drying up. You understand the spiritual significance of the Euphrates drying up. It preceded the fall of Babylon in the ancient history. You understand? So, did Babylon last forever? No, it fell. Another little interesting tidbit of history here is some of you know that Saddam Hussein, a few years ago, you know, he invaded Kuwait. And you had the two Gulf Wars. One of our sons was in the Marines, and he fought in one of those wars. And Saddam Hussein had plans to rebuild ancient Babylon because the prophecy in Isaiah and Jeremiah said Babylon would never be rebuilt. And if you want it, it's Isaiah chapter 13. It says Babylon will fall, it will become ruins, it will become heaps, it will never be inhabited, it will never be rebuilt. Someone told that to Saddam Hussein. Nebuchadnezzar was a hero. In fact, you got a picture here of Saddam Hussein with Nebuchadnezzar behind him. If you look at some of the Iraqi coins he printed, he's got his face and Nebuchadnezzar's face. Saddam Hussein said, I am the reincarnation. He wanted to be the leader of the Arab world. That's why he attacked Iran. And he started to try to rebuild Babylon. It got stopped during the first Gulf War. Then there was a brief pause. He tried to renew construction. It got stopped again. He was trying to overthrow the Hebrew prophecy. You cannot overthrow. Heaven and earth will pass away. God's word will not pass away. Ancient Babylon is still heaps today. Isn't that interesting? And Saddam is gone. Question, keep going. It says, another kingdom will arise after you. Now we're going from gold to what metal? To silver. This is the Persian kingdom. Started out as the Medo-Persian kingdom. It ended up where the Persians became the dominant kingdom under Cyrus the Great. I've been there, friends. You go to the British Museum. Here is the Cyrus cylinder that was excavated near ancient Babylon. In the cylinder, it says that he conquered Babylon and he let the captives of the Babylonians go back to their native lands. God foretold in the book of Jeremiah, it's also, you find it in the end of 2 Chronicles, that the children of Israel would be captives in Babylon for 70 years, and after 70 years, they would be allowed to go back, and they did. You know, if for no other reason, if you're going to believe the Bible, believe it because the Jews are an unusual people. There is no other people in the world that has been dispossessed from their land three times. In the days of Jacob, they went down to Egypt, but they got it back after the Exodus. Then they were carried off to Babylon, but they got it back during the time of Cyrus. Then they were scattered by the Romans for 1900 years, and they got it back, and they remained a distinct people. Every other nation that was conquered, intermarried, disappeared, lost their identity. Try and find someone that speaks Comanche today. They used to occupy the Great Plains. But the Jews, God said they would come back. They'd remain distinct. It's incredible. Prophecy comes true. And then, silver was the principal currency in ancient Persia. It is a silver kingdom. Here's the expanse of Persia. It gets bigger, you'll notice. The kingdoms are getting bigger, but it would not last. He said you'd have silver, but the silver would transition. Number 8. What metal would represent the kingdom that followed Medo-Persia? And another third kingdom of what? Bronze. Some of your Bibles will say brass. Technically, it's not brass because they didn't use brass back then. Brass also has tin in it. Makes it a little shinier. This is really bronze. Which shall rule over all the earth. Again, they're talking about it's going to be an empire that's going to spread everywhere. And someone said, I want to back up because I left out a note here I want to read. The brass kingdom of Greece came into power with Alexander the Great from 331 BC when he conquered the Persians, and it lasted till about 168. Alexander the Great marched his armies approximately 11,000 miles in mostly 10 years. They didn't march the whole time. He conquered the world. He was, taught by Aristotle. Very bright, military genius, very brave. And he spread the Greek culture. They call it Hellenization. Even at the time of Christ, Greek was the language of learning. And even governments of the world, the Roman governments, were influenced by the Greeks and these great philosophers of Greek. One historian, Arian, said, I am persuaded that there is no nation, city, or people then in being where his name did not reach. For which reason, whatever origin he might boast or claim to himself, there seems to have been some divine hand presiding over his birth and his actions. But even this kingdom would not last. Now, the kingdom of Greece, guess what they used as armor? bronze. They were known as the brazen soldiers because they used bronze swords and bronze shields and bronze helmets. There's an example of one that was recovered that you see there on your screen. And here is a map of the extent of Alexander's kingdom. He marched his armies all the way to the borders of India, where they were fighting elephants, and extended up into to Egypt and Damascus and Greece. I want you to notice something that's happening here with these different kingdoms. And they all occupied Jerusalem. The Greeks were a little better at first. Alexander was. Some of the later Greek leaders like Antiochus Epiphanes and others were very brutal to the Jewish nation. But each kingdom is lasting longer, but the metal is less valuable than the one before. Babylonians about 70 years, then you get the Persians, which lasts longer, but it's silver, not worth as much as gold. Then you got the bronze, which isn't worth as much as silver, but it's harder. Each one is harder than the one before it. They last longer and they're harder. And watch what happens next. Number 9, what metal represents the fourth kingdom? You read here, Daniel chapter 2, verse 40, and the fourth kingdom will be as strong as iron. The Romans had mastered the forging of iron weapons, and that's one reason they were able to conquer. Now, I just want you to think about this. Are you aware in the book of Daniel that he foretells later in Daniel the Greek Empire by name, calls it Grecia? The chances of the Greeks ruling the world when Daniel said that, no offense to anybody out there right now, I hope I don't offend anybody, but if I were to tell you in 100 years, the world's going to be ruled by Uruguay. Who here would predict that? No, I mean, anything's possible, but who would predict that? The likelihood of the Greeks and the Romans ruling the world when Daniel made that prophecy was ludicrous. They saw no way that would happen. But he foretold it, and he even foretold the Greeks by name in Daniel chapter 8. Now, he says, his fourth kingdom, a kingdom of iron. The Romans had mastered iron. They were getting the iron from the forges and the mines in southern Spain, a place called Tarsus. The iron monarchy conquered the Greeks in 168 at the Battle of Arbela. And you think about it, with an iron sword, you can literally cut a bronze sword in two. So the weapons made a big difference. That's why the medieval knights, they had this armor mail. And in the Bible, you can read how the soldiers of Israel, they couldn't get any iron from the Philistines, and the Philistines were able to subdue them because the Philistines had the iron, and only David and Saul and Jonathan had actually iron swords. And so that was like, you know, having nuclear weapons back then. If you had the iron, it was iron nails that pierced Jesus' hands, and an iron spear that pierced his side, and iron swords killed the babies in Bethlehem. And the Romans ruled with an iron fist, and they lasted longer than the Greeks. They had, for a while there was what they called the Pax Romana. There was the Roman peace, and it was during the time of the Roman Empire God saw fit for the incarnation. God came into the world during that time for good reason. There was a period of time during the time of Augustus Caesar for 40 years where there was a degree of peace. They built roads everywhere. So when Christ came and the knowledge of the gospel and Pentecost was poured out and Jews from all over the Roman Empire heard about Jesus, they scattered all around the world and the gospel spread. And Jesus said something outrageous. This carpenter said, "My teachings will go to all of the world." And it did. And the Romans influenced the government of every world to world today. You know, we're still. Why do we have a month called July? Julius Caesar. Why do we have a month called August? Augustus Caesar. Why is February short? Because Augustus Caesar wanted a month that was just as long as July, so he had to take some days off of February to put it on August. Why do we have a day of a week called Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday? We got it from the Romans. sun worship, moon worship, Saturn worship, Odin worship, Thor worship. It all kind of came from the background of the Roman power. Roman power was more centered around the Mediterranean, but it was an extremely powerful, long-lasting empire. Now Daniel's foretelling things 1,000 years in advance. You've got to be a pretty good prophet to do that. How many of you know what's going to happen a week from now? The weatherman said it was supposed to rain today. Praise God he was wrong. Amen? So, I mean, and they've got a lot of technology we don't have. Number 10, what would happen after the fall of the Roman Empire? The kingdom will be divided as the toes and the feet were partly of iron and partly of clay, so the kingdom will be partly strong and partly fragile. The Roman Empire began to crumble about 476 BC. Didn't happen any one particular day, but because they were so preoccupied with entertainment and the family fell apart. You know, Augustus Caesar, he believed in marriage. He, in spite of his problems, he supported the strength of the family. Then you got people like Nero and Diocletian, and these guys were despicable. And the kingdom became weak, and the soldiers became weak. And the barbarians and the Aryans, they came in from the north, and the kingdom fragmented into 10 parts, just like the 10 toes on the image that Nebuchadnezzar dreamed about. Until now you've moved from the iron to the iron mixed with clay. But it says later in Daniel, not just clay, it says miry clay. Now what happened, notice, up to this point, these kingdoms are occupied around Israel during the time of the iron Rome. But during the time of Christ, when the Romans ruled, the gospel and God's people then spread. And even the Jews were conquered and the great diaspora, they spread everywhere. So now it's not just restricted to the Middle East. Now we've got the 10 divisions of the Roman Empire that end up spreading around the world. I think it's very interesting. It says, but there shall be in it the strength of the iron, for as much as you saw the iron mixed with miry clay. Who would like to guess what is the number one building material in the world today by far? It's called reinforced concrete, which is what? Iron mixed with miry clay. Karen and I went to China a few years ago, and the national bird in China is the building crane. They have cranes everywhere. Concrete took a minute to get that, right? There are cranes everywhere and concrete dust and everywhere you go, New York City. The Romans actually were one of the first ones to master concrete, but it wasn't reinforced at first. This is the Pantheon, one of the oldest concrete buildings. Romans built it, still standing today. Number 11. Would these kingdoms ever succeed in uniting? What did the prophecy say? Daniel 2:43, they'll mingle themselves with the seed of men, but they will not adhere one to another, as iron does not mix with clay. You know, they all tried. They all tried to get back the power of the Caesars. You've heard of Kaiser Wilhelm. You know how you, what does the word Kaiser mean? It's German for czar. I mean, German for Caesar. And what does the word czar mean? It's Russian for Caesar. And Hitler wanted the Third Reich. He wanted to be the Caesar. They wanted to reunite it. And the English tried to do it through marriage. Queen Victoria was called the grandmother of Europe because her kids and grandkids were married into every family in Europe. But did it unite? Or did we still have World War I and World War II? Karen and I were in Poland last year, and they're afraid another world war is going to break out from Ukraine and Russia and spread across Europe and NATO. Who will set up the final kingdom? Praise God. The Bible says there is a stone. There is a rock of ages, cut without man's hands, because he came in the image of God. And in the days of these kings, friends, we are living in the days of the final empire. The God of heaven will set up a kingdom that will never be destroyed. All the other kingdoms passed away, but there's a kingdom that will never be destroyed. Amen? Quickly review. Go back, and I want to put it on the stage so you see it again, and you call out the answers with me. All right, let's see if we can get our statue back up here. So you've got the gold. What kingdom is the gold? Babylon, followed by silver, which represented? Medo-Persia, 539 to 331, followed by what kingdom? Greece, 331 to 168, followed by the iron of what kingdom? Rome. And then you get the iron and clay, which is the divided kingdom from the 10 nations of Europe that you have, the Alemanni and the Franks and the Saxons, the Burgundians, the Suevi, and I'll list them for you another night. And that kingdom goes to what's next? All these other kingdoms are destroyed because the Rock of Ages comes. Jesus is coming like a heavenly asteroid, and all the others will be wiped out. What does the stone do to the other world kingdoms? You watched while the stone was cut out without hands. It struck the image on its feet of iron and clay and broke them in pieces. And the stone that struck them, the image, became a great mountain and filled the whole earth. It says, blessed are the meek. What's the answer? They will fill the earth, friends. I want to be one of those that will be in that kingdom. Do you know the spiritual kingdom came when Jesus came? Jesus said, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. What did the king say when he heard this vision? After hearing Daniel's clear interpretation of the dream, Nebuchadnezzar said, truly, your God is a God of gods and a Lord of kings, since you could reveal this secret. Now, how many of you think that God can tell the future? If everything else in this vision has happened right on schedule, why would we doubt the last thing's going to happen? Friends, we are living on the very cusp of eternity now. The next thing is for Jesus to come. Karen and I were walking around town today, and we got a little mixed up by the high rises and the busyness of the streets, and she said, are we going in the right direction? I said, yeah, we're trying to get down to 37th Street, and we're up here at 45th Street, and notice this, it went from 45th to 44th. What do I expect next? 43rd? Then what's coming? 42nd? 41? 40? Would I expect eventually I'd get down to 37th Street? Yeah. If everything has happened on schedule, why would we doubt that Jesus is going to come? Amen. God's word is eternal. It does not fail. I want to be part of that spiritual kingdom so I can be part of that eternal kingdom. How about you, friends? Amen. We're going to have prayer with our friends here before we go off the air, but don't forget, next program is when? Tomorrow night. It is the arch villain of prophecy. Why is there good and evil in the world? You don't want to miss it. We will see you then. God bless you.